This is Steffen's polyhedron, and it does something that Euler thought was impossible. I don't know if you've ever played with these sorts of construction pieces before. You can use them to make 3D shapes, and the polyhedrons you end up with have rigid faces, but the edges are hinged. These are kids' toys, but whenever I see something like this, I always think, well, I guess I'm building the platonic solids now. One thing I noticed, especially with the icosahedron, is that they're incredibly wobbly because of these hinges until you get quite close to the end. The whole thing can flex when just two of the faces are missing. But if I add one face or the two final faces, the whole thing becomes rigid. Here's a polyhedron that is rigid but becomes flexible when you remove just one of the faces. Euler thought all polyhedrons were rigid, but check this out. See how it flexes like that? It's not a huge amount of movement, but it doesn't have to be to serve the purpose of being a proof, by counterexample, that not all polyhedrons need to be rigid. Here it is as a net, and interestingly, it's symmetrical down this center line. But actually, it's not properly symmetrical, because this line is a valley fold, and this line is a mountain fold. A huge thank you to Ivan Miranda, by the way, for designing and printing this thing. It's a really clever design, actually. It uses printer filament for the hinges. Ivan has all sorts of really clever 3D printing ideas. I strongly recommend you check out his excellent channel. The link is in the card and the description. It's a strange thing to hold in your hands, actually. I suppose because over the years, I've built up an intuition for polyhedrons that says polyhedrons are rigid. So this is behaving in a way that I just haven't experienced before. Ivan printed one of the faces with a big hole in it. So if I switch to that one, you can see what's going on inside. It can flex until these two faces touch. And you have the same limit in the other direction with the mirror image of those faces on the other side. So that's the full range of movement. Augustine Cauchy proved in 1815 that actually all convex polyhedrons are rigid. So Euler was at least partly right, but what if a polyhedron was concave? What if it had indented bits like this? This is a concave polyhedron, for example, though it's rigid. And for a long time, it wasn't known whether a flexible concave polyhedron existed. The first example of a flexible concave polyhedron actually wasn't that satisfying. That's because the faces intersect. Look, it is flexible, but because the faces cross through each other, it can only exist in four dimensions. Robert Connolly discovered the first proper flexible polyhedron in 1977. It's this monster with 18 faces. This much simpler version with 14 faces was discovered by Klaus Steffen a year later, and this is the thing that Ivan printed for me. It's still not known whether a simpler flexible polyhedron exists. I wanted to show you a couple of related structures that are interesting. This polyhedron isn't flexible, but it's bistable. And the two stable states that it can be in are quite close to each other. And because this exists in the real world where infinitely rigid faces can't exist, we can actually flip between those two stable states, which is fun. This is a strange one. It's Jessen's octahedron. It isn't flexible in the same way as Steffen's polyhedron, but it is infinitesimally flexible. What does that mean? Well, if you think about a structure like this one, if this was perfectly rigid, then there would be no movement at all. But in the real world, these bars would be a little bit stretchy, which means that I can pull up on this joint. And if I were to plot the lengthening of this rod against the vertical motion of the joint, it would look like this. You can't move the joint without stretching the bar. But what about a structure like this? How does this bar lengthen as I pull up on this joint? Well, look, the curve flattens out as you approach zero movement. So at the very beginning, it's possible to move that joint without the bar lengthening at all. But then as soon as the joint does move, the bar will have to lengthen. In other words, the structure is only flexible in the limit of no flex. That kind of sounds like a mathematician's bad sleight of hand. But actually, it does make sense intuitively when you think about it in the real world. A structure like this is infinitesimally flexible, but because it exists in the real world, I can actually flex it. And it feels like it takes no force to do so until it has traveled some distance. Whereas with this structure, it feels like I can't move it at all. It's easy to make an infinitesimally flexible joint. You just take a straight rod and you put the joint in the middle of it. The formal way of saying that is if a joint is collinear with two other joints, then it will be infinitesimally flexible. Similarly, in three dimensions, a polyhedron will be infinitesimally flexible if one of the vertices is coplanar, but that's kind of obvious and boring, whereas Jessen's polyhedron is able to achieve infinitesimal flexibility without having to resort to coplanar vertices. I've got a bigger one here, and what's interesting is when I squeeze it, I can feel air coming out, and incredibly, that's actually proof that Jessen's polyhedron isn't a true flexible polyhedron in the same sense as Steffen's polyhedron. That's because Connolly proved that the volume of a flexible polyhedron doesn't change as the polyhedron flexes. It's called the Bellows conjecture because a polyhedron cannot be used as bellows. By the way, if you replace all the concave edges with rods and all the convex edges with strings, you end up with this tensegrity structure. That's pretty cool, isn't it? I made a whole video about tensegrity structures, link to that in the card and the description. One final thought, when I was playing with the construction pieces, I was looking at how flexible does a polyhedron become when you remove one of the faces. I could only ever create a flex with 1 degree of freedom. Like with the icosahedron, with several of the faces removed, I can wobble the structure like this, that's 1 degree of freedom, but I can also independently wobble the structure like this, that's a 2nd degree of freedom. This has 2 degrees of freedom. Does there exist a polyhedron where if you remove just one of the faces, you end up with 2 degrees of freedom? If you fancy having a play, I'd love to see what you've come up with. The best way to share your discoveries is probably on my Discord server, specifically the Science Fair Project channel. Link to the invite in the description. Join us. But anyway, I suspect that 2 degrees of freedom when you remove a single face from a polyhedron is not possible. I'm calling it the mold conjecture. So I used to get these creepy phone calls where the person on the other end of the line knew a lot about me, like my name, where I live, things like that. And I always think this must be a company that I've interacted before, but then it would turn out not to be. And that's because there are these other companies called data brokers that collect data about you and then sell them on to those other companies that then call you up or email you or send you something in the mail. I don't get those phone calls anymore, and that's because I went through a process that's almost impossible for one person to do on their own. Like, it is possible to contact these data brokers and say, stop selling my data and delete it. The problem is there are literally hundreds of these data brokers, and they all want to be contacted in different ways. Some want an email, it's got to be worded specifically. Some want you to fill in a web form. It's an immense amount of effort for one person, but for the sponsor of this video, Incogni, well, they've already done it. They did the legwork up front, and now they've automated it. So now you can give Incogni the right to act on your behalf, and they'll go out and they'll contact all those data brokers in the exact way they need to be contacted. They'll deal with the rejections and all that sort of stuff, and it all just happens in the background. Look, these are the companies that are now no longer allowed to store data about me. You know, it's just one of those things that I knew I wanted to do, but I couldn't see how I would get it done, and now it's done. And it feels good. And if you're interested, the promo on this one's really good. The first 100 people to go to incogni.com/science and use promo code science at checkout will get 60% off. The link is also in the description, so check out Incogni today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to hit subscribe, and the algorithm thinks you'll enjoy this video next.